Okay friends, so in this video lecture, we will see how to perform the experiment of a Wien bridge oscillator using the operational amplifier. So first of all, if you see, what is the difference between the amplifier and the oscillator circuit, or what is the basically an oscillator circuit? So here, we know that if you have this amplifier circuit, then this amplifier circuit, we provide the input voltage, and here we have this kind of the output voltage. Now if my input voltage is of a very small amplitude, then you will get the output voltage of a large amplitude. So here whatever the energy is there, that energy is called a AC energy. AC energy. Here at the input, we are also applying the AC energy. So, at the input, small amount of the AC energy is there. In the output, large amount of the AC energy is there. Then, how come this large amount of the AC energy has come? So, basically, we know that there is a conservation law of energy, that we cannot produce the energy, only we can transfer the energy. So, basically, here, if you have this amplifier, then this amplifier always will provide a kind of a DC energy. DC energy in the form of a battery. So, the amplifier is converting this DC energy, whatever the DC energy is there, it is converting a DC energy into a AC energy. So, there is a transformation of the energy. But this transformation of the energy will take place only when you apply the input signal. If the input signal will be zero, then you will not get a AC energy in the output of the amplifier. Means we can say that the amplifier is a device which converts the DC energy into AC energy when the input signal is present. Now what is oscillator? So, if you look at this oscillator, then again, it is a kind of an amplifier circuit. Here, when you are talking about the input and output, so we have this input, we have this output, and the DC source is connected, so we call it a DC energy. But in an oscillator, the input signal is not required. My input voltage. Input voltage means you should understand the external input signal. This external input signal is zero, and without any input signal, you will get the output that is a AC signal. And here we have this kind of a AC energy. So here you can say, that the DC energy is converted into an AC energy when my external input signal is zero. So, oscillator doesn't require an external input, but it has an input, and this input will come out from the output. It is in the form of a feedback. Here, we have a kind of a feedback network, and whatever the output signal is there, we take the fraction of this output signal, and this feedback signal is connected as at an input of the oscillator. So whatever my feedback signal is there, it is an input signal for the oscillator. So you can say oscillator is a circuit which converts the DC energy into AC energy without any external input signal. Okay? Now let us see what is the condition for the oscillator. So, in SIBS, we already have learned about a positive feedback and a negative feedback. So, in an oscillator, we require a positive feedback, and this whatever the internal amplifier is there, it has to satisfy a Barkhausen criteria. So, here in the oscillator, again we have a kind of a amplifier circuit. This is known as an internal amplifier. Now, it has an input, it has an output, you can say output is there. But we require a feedback network. So, feedback network is there. And the output of this amplifier is given to a feedback network. Then the output of the feedback network is connected at an input of the amplifier circuit. Now here, whatever the feedback signal is there, any input signal is there, it should be in a same phase. Means there should be a kind of a positive feedback. So here suppose my input signal has a positive cycle, then we know that the amplifier is going to introduce a 180 degree of the phase shift. So in the output, it is going to be a inverted. Now this signal is given to the feedback network. And here the feedback network will also introduce another 180 degree of a phase shift. So the output signal, or you can say this one feedback signal. This feedback signal and your input signal both are in the same phase. So that kind of a feedback is known as a positive feedback. So in the oscillator, we require a positive feedback. Positive feedback means what? The phase difference between the input signal and feedback signal. Should be zero, or you can say, or a 360 degree. Then only you can have a positive. So this is the one of the condition for the oscillator, that there should be a kind of a positive feedback. Then what is the another condition? Here the another condition means you have to consider what is the gain of the amplifier. Suppose the gain of this internal amplifier is AV. And my feedback factor is K. Feedback factor means how much percent of the output voltage you are feeding to the input signal. So here there is a Barthausen criteria for the sustained oscillation. For any kind of oscillator, the Barthausen criteria has to be satisfied. And what is the Barthausen criteria? That the K into AV must be equal to 1. This K into AV, here, it is known as a loop gain. Because this is a kind of a loop. Remember that the amplifier output is connected to a feedback and the output of the feedback is connected back to the input. So it is a kind of a loop, and the loop gain has to be a unity. That is known as the Barthausen criteria. Then only you can have a sustained oscillation. Okay? So one of the condition is K into AV is equal to 1, and another condition means whatever the phase difference produced by the K into AV has to be a 0 degree or a 360 degree. This is known as a Barthausen criteria. Okay? So now let us see a circuit for the wind bridge oscillator. So here we are using an operational amplifier. Already you are familiar with the operational amplifier. And in this operational amplifier, here we have this feedback part that is controlling the gain of the amplifier circuit. And what is the important part? That the important part is that this is my wind bridge. This is a wind bridge. This wind bridge is connected between the output and the input. This is the output terminal of your amplifier circuit, and this one is the input for the amplifier circuit. So between the output and the input, this feedback, this wind bridge network is connected. Now, what is the characteristics of a wind bridge network? So here you can see that resistance R1 and C1, it is connected in series, and resistance R2 and C2, they are connected in parallel. So if you look at this circuit, then the circuit is like this. Resistance R1 and the C1 is in series, and then the resistance R2 and the C2 is connected in parallel. So here if we apply the input voltage and if we see what is the output voltage across the R2 and C2, then here you will find that whatever the output voltage is there, this output voltage is changing with the frequency. So basically if we see this network, then this R1 C1 is forming a kind of a filter circuit. R2 C2 is also kind of a filter circuit. So basically this is a low pass filter. Low pass filter, and this combination is called a high pass filter. So when these two filters are connected together, then the wind brick is working as a band pass filter. Remember, here the characteristics of a wind brick is a, like a band pass filter. Now, if we apply a input voltage, here if you apply the frequency F1, F2, F3, and we measure what is the voltage VO1, VO2, VO3, then you will get the curve like this. Here, on the x-axis, let us say the frequency is there, on a y-axis, the output voltage is there. Then as the frequency is increasing, the output voltage is go on increasing, and for particular frequency, output voltage will be a maximum, and then here, this output voltage is go on decreasing. This is the characteristics of a band pass filter. So, for which frequency it is going to be a maximum? This frequency is given as 1 upon 2 pi RC. Remember, it's a kind of a resonance. You can say the characteristics of a wind bridge oscillator, wind bridge is a kind of a resonance circuit. So for a particular frequency, the output voltage is maximum. So sometimes this wind bridge is also known as a frequency selective network. Remember, frequency selective network. Correct? So at the input, you apply number of the frequency, but for a particular frequency, output voltage will be a maximum. But what is the another important property, and that is very useful for the oscillator? Here, instead of an output voltage, if I will draw a graph for the phase difference between the input and output, remember, here, if I will draw the graph for the input and the output against the frequency F, this is the phase difference, you can say, 5 is there, then you will find that at particular frequency where your output voltage is maximum, at that point the phase difference is going to be a 0 degree. And for a low frequency, the phase difference is maximum and then it is go on decreasing and then again it is go on changing from the 0. Here the phase difference will be plus 90 degree and at this point the phase difference is minus 90 degree. So, here, whatever the frequency is selected by the wind brick, for that, the phase difference is going to be a 0. And that is the important property for making the oscillator. Correct? So, now, try to understand this circuit. That here, the wind brick is there. This is connected, the wind brick is connected between the input and output. here, whatever the junction of the low pass filter and the high pass filter is there, it is connected at the input. And you can see it is an operational amplifier. Operational amplifier is a two input terminal. One is called a inverting terminal, another is known as a non-inverting terminal. So the output voltage, or you can say the feedback voltage, is given to a non-inverting terminal. So this is nothing but it is a non-inverting amplifier. Here operational amplifier is a non-inverting amplifier. So for a non-inverting amplifier, what is the formula for the gain of the amplifier? It is given as voltage gain is equal to 1 plus Rf by R. Correct? 1 plus Rf by R. And for if you do this analysis, means if you find out the gain of the amplifier, if you find out what is the feedback factor, and then if you take a, if you apply the Barkhausen criteria, then from the Barkhausen criteria, you will find that the gain of the amplifier must be a 3. Plus 3, remember. Why it is plus 3? Why it is a plus 3? Because we know that whatever the wind bridge is there, wind bridge is not going to introduce any phase difference. Means the phase difference introduced by this is going to be a 0 degree. Okay? Now what is the Barkhausen criteria? That the loop gain, the phase of the loop gain has to be a 0 or the 360 degree. So if the wind bridge is not going to introduce any phase, means whatever the amplifier we are using, it has to introduce the phase difference of a 360 degree. And that's why we are using a non-inverting terminal. So when you apply a non-inverting terminal, a signal to the non-inverting terminal, then the signal is not going to be inverted. The phase difference between the input and the output will be, you can say it is a 360 degree or a 0 degree. So here, particularly in this oscillator, the total phase is introduced by the amplifier itself, and whatever the feedback network we have, this is my feedback network. This feedback network is not going to introduce any phase, and that is the 0 degree. So in this way, the Barkhausen criteria, or you can say the positive feedback condition, is going to be satisfied. Now, when we write K into AV is equal to 1, K into base, you can find out what is the feedback factor, what is the gain of this, and from that, by doing the analysis here, means this analysis already done in a theory, so I am not going to derive. So, here, the minimum gain of this amplifier must be a 3 plus 3, remember, not a minus 3, because it is a non-inverting amplifier. So here the amplifier gain will be a 3, and I already mentioned that gain is nothing but AV is equal to 1 plus RF by R, and here 1 plus, so RF must be a twice of the R. So here we have a 5 kilo ohm at the input, the resistance is 5 kilo ohm, then what will be the feedback resistance? This is my a feedback resistance Rf. So it has to be a 10 kilo ohm, and this is a 5 kilo ohm, and there you will get the gain of 3. This exact value of the gain you can set with the help of the resistance R4. Remember, if it is slightly less than 3, you will not get the oscillation. If it is greater than 3, yes, if the gain of the amplifier will be greater than 3, then the center is going to be distorted. And sometimes you instead of getting a sine wave, you will get a kind of a clipping in a positive cycle as well as a negative cycle, and the shape of the signal is going to be a square wave. So here, this is the condition. When you perform the experiment, then at that time you have to adjust the value of the RPO so that in the output or in the CRO you can see exactly a sine wave. Now, what would be the frequency of oscillation? Just already mentioned that the particular frequency, when it is selected, then it is given by 1 upon 2 pi under root of R1 C1 R2 C2. This is if the R1 and R2 are different. R1 and R2 are different. C1 and C2 is different. Then you can calculate the frequency of oscillation using this formula. But if they are same, if R1 is equal to R2 is equal to R, C1 is equal to C2 is equal to C, then the frequency of oscillation is given by 1 upon 2 pi RC. So in this experiment, what we have to do, that either we change the value of resistance or we change the value of capacitor, and we will measure what is the frequency of oscillation. So here, when you are changing the resistance R1, at the same time you change the R2, or by changing the C1 and C2, the frequency of the oscillation is going to change. For a different value of a resistance and capacitor, find out what is the frequency of oscillation and verify with this theoretical formula, that is F is equal to 1 upon 2 pi RC. Okay? So if you see the observation table, in this observation table, we are changing the value of the resistance from 15 kilo ohm to a 3.3 kilo ohm, and we are keeping the value of capacitor constant, that is a 0.01. Now, you have to measure the periodic time from the oscilloscope, that is a periodic time means that if we have this kind of a sine wave, then if we measure what is the time period between the two peak of the signal, that is the periodic time that you can measure from the oscilloscope, and then you find out what is the frequency of oscillation. And theoretically, by placing this value of resistance and capacitor, you can calculate and compare with what is the experimental value of the frequency. So this is how to perform the Wien bridge oscillator. Now let us see the experimental board and how to measure this frequency. Now here you can perform the experiment in two different ways. Then you can use the ready-made board where the circuit is connected. Only you have to connect a power supply and the oscilloscope. You go on changing the value of a resistance and measure the frequency. Then another way of performing the experiment is that whatever the circuit is there, this circuit you can construct on a breadboard, and then you can test the circuit with the help of a power supply and on an oscilloscope. Correct? So let us see a breadboard, that how we can construct the circuit on a breadboard.
Okay friends, now we will perform the experiment on this ready-made board. And in this board, now you can see the circuit diagram. Here we have a 741 operational amplifier, and it is working as a non-inverting amplifier, and Wien bridge network is here where the resistance and capacitor are in series, and here resistance capacitors are in parallel.
And basically you can see the pin number 6 is the output of the operational amplifier, and pin number 3 is a non-inverting input of the operational amplifier, and between the pin number 6 and 3 the bridge network is connected. So this is my feedback network. Now to set the gain of the amplifier, here you can change the value of the feedback resistance, and for that the variable potentiometer is given. Now already we have discussed in the theory that the required gain of the amplifier should be a 3, and this gain you can set either by changing the value of resistance R1 or by changing the value of resistance RF. Okay, now let us see the connection. To the operational amplifier we have to connect a plus 12, minus 12 and ground. We have this dual power supply. So the plus 12 is connected here, the ground is connected at a common terminal, and the minus 12 is connected here. Now to see this waveform, we are going to connect a oscilloscope at the pin number 6. This is the ground terminal, this is the output terminal. Either you can connect here or you can connect it here. So these are the connection for the experimental board. Now look at this oscilloscope. This is known as a digital storage oscilloscope. It is just like an analog oscilloscope, but we have the facility to store the waveform. Now if you look at this oscilloscope, front panel of the oscilloscope, then the volt per division knob is there, so you can change the amplitude of the signal. Here the time per division or the second per division is mentioned, so we can set the time per division, or the we can set the periodic time of the waveform. And then the rest of the terminals, the rest of the switches, you will be familiar as you are going to operate the oscilloscope. Okay, now let us start the experiment. Now we will switch on the power supply. So you can see here the two LEDs are on, means the supply is given to the experimental board. And now you can see the waveform on the oscilloscope. You can see there is a kind of a clipping on a positive cycle of the signal, as well as the clipping is on the negative cycle of the signal. Correct? So this indicates the gain of the amplifier is slightly greater than 3. So here you can set this gain using this potentiometer. So you can see that as I am changing this, what is the change in the waveform? Now here there is no oscillation, means the gain of the amplifier is now less than 3. Now as we increase this, then for a particular value of the resistance the oscillation will start. You can see the oscillations are there and it is a sinusoidal. Now if I will increase the gain, then the clipping will start, the signal is going to be distorted. So when you are performing the experiment, then you have to set this potentiometer so that you can have a kind of a sinusoidal waveform. Now in a windbridge network, I have connected a 4.7 kilo ohm resistance and a capacitor of 0.01 microfarad. Now to find out the frequency, you have to measure what is the periodic time. And for that, here we have a two-channel oscilloscope. So here in the digital storage oscilloscope, there is a facility that directly you can see what is the frequency or what is the periodic time of the signal. So here it is mentioned the frequency is 3.24 kilohertz. And what is the periodic time? That periodic time is 308 or 307 microseconds. Periodic time means what? The time period between the two peak of the signal. Correct? If it is not given, then there is a facility for the cursor. And here you can set the button for the cursor. So when you set, when you press the button for the cursor, now you can see the two cursors are there. And by changing this position, you can set the cursor. So I am setting this cursor. This is the cursor number 1. and I am setting this cursor on the one of the peak of the sinusoidal wave, then the another cursor you can set by pressing this. Here the cursor number 2, that is representing the position of the cursor 2. So when you are pressing this, and now you can set the position of the cursor 2. If I will set another peak of a sinusoidal wave, then what is the difference between, so these are the time cursor. So the time difference between these two, here it is indicated that 304 microsecond is there. And from this periodic time, you can calculate the frequency, f is equal to 1 upon t, and you can find out the frequency. So here in this board, the resistance is variable. Now instead of 4.7k, if you are connecting a 3.k, 3.3k, then again you measure what is the periodic time and find out the frequency. For at least 3 to 4 different value of resistance, you can perform the experiment and then match your reading with the theoretical formula, that is f is equal to 1 upon 2 pi rc. Here we have performed the experiment on a ready-made board. Now the same circuit you can also construct on a breadboard. Here you can see the breadboard, the number of the holes are there, and there are number of the rows and the number of the columns are there. Here if you see, one of this column is this, second column is there, third column is here, and all these columns are connected together. Here in this column there are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 holes are there, so all the 5 holes are connected together. Same way you take the any other column, this column number 10 or 11 is there, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so all these holes are connected together. Now if you look at this row, then the first row is there, there are 5 holes, there are another 5 holes are there, then the one more 5 holes are there, all these holes are connected internally. This is the row number 1 you can see. The row number 2 is there, also this 5 holes plus 5 plus 5, all these holes are connected together. Same way if you see the bottom of the breadboard, then in this row all these holes are connected together, and normally this row we are using for giving a supply voltage. So here in the circuit, if you have to give a plus VCC or minus VCC or a ground line, then you can connect a plus VCC line here, minus VCC line here, and the ground line here. So that will be common for all the components. Now, how to connect the circuit? So in our Wien bridge oscillator, you can see the operational amplifier is there, and the surrounding operational amplifier, number of the components are there. So now the operational amplifier is this. It is a 741. 741, and it has 8 pin. Now the pin numbers are important, remember. Now in this IC, if you see, there is a notch, correct? So on the left side of the notch is representing the pin number 1. So this one is the pin number 1, pin number 2, pin number 3, pin number 4. Now you have to move in a anti-clockwise. So 1, 2, 3, 4, pin number 5 is here, 6, 7 and 8. So you take any IC, then first of all you find out where is the notch, or there in some of the IC the dot will be there, and that dot is indicating the pin number 1, and then you have to move in a anti-clockwise. Now to construct this circuit on a breadboard, so here we are inserting this IC between these two points, between these two row. So now you can see this IC is inserted in a breadboard. Now this is the pin number 1. So it means this hole, this hole, this hole, and all these holes are connected to the pin number 1. So whatever the component you have to connect on a pin number 1, you can utilize all these holes. Same way, this is a pin number 4 and the holes are connected with the pin number 4, the pin number 5, pin number 8. So here all these holes you can use the hole for a building a circuit. Now if you look at the circuit, then I have to connect a pin number 7 to a supply voltage. This kind of a wire for the connection of the supply voltage. Here, where is the pin number 7? Pin number 7 is here. Pin number 7 is here. So you can insert the wire at this point. So this is the connection for a plus 12 volt. Then the pin number 4 is connected to minus 12. So where is the pin number 4? Pin number 4 is here, and you can connect this wire to this point. So you have to connect this to the minus 12 volt, correct? And in this way you can construct the circuit. Now if you look at this on a pin number 2, I have to connect one resistance which is connected to ground. Now here the resistance is there. Then now if I will consider this line as a ground, then between the pin number 2 and ground, I have to connect a resistance. I have to insert the resistance. So this is a resistance. How you can insert? You bend the resistance according to the distance between the pin number 2 and the ground. And then you can insert this resistance. So this terminal is connected to the ground, and you can use any one of this hole for connecting the resistance. At the pin number 2, we have connected a resistance. Same way, you can connect another resistance to a pin number 2, which is a 10 kilo ohm, and then it is connected to a feedback network. So one more resistance, and then it is connected between the pin number 2 and 6. So I am inserting the resistor, one of the terminal to the pin number 2, and inserting the another terminal to the pin number 6. So you can connect in this way. Correct? So then you take a different component and connect all the components on this breadboard. Finally, if you see the wind bridge oscillator circuit is connected on this breadboard, and you can verify with your circuit diagram. So here now we are connecting a supply. So this is the pin number 7 where I have to connect a plus 12 volt. Then this is the terminal for the ground, which is connected to a ground, and this black wire is connected to a minus 12. This is my feedback network. You can see the resistance capacitors are in series, and this resistance capacitors are in parallel. And junction of the series and the parallel combination is connected to a pin number 3 through a yellow wire. Now if you look at the circuit diagram, pin number 6 is my output, you can take the output from the resistance also. Here, on a breadboard, you can see the resistance is there. This is the pin number 6 connected through a white wire, and I am connecting a oscilloscope. And another terminal of the oscilloscope is connected to the ground, because this is my ground line. So in this way, you can prepare your oscillator circuit on a breadboard. Now, if I will switch on the supply, then you can see the waveform on the oscilloscope. So just now there is no output. It means the gain of the amplifier is less than 3. So through this potentiometer, through this potentiometer you can set, and here you can see the oscillation is there, correct? Now no oscillation means the gain is less than 3. I am setting this value of the potentiometer so that you can see a sinusoidal wave. Now again, if I will increase, then the signal is going to be distorted. It indicates the gain is large. So now set for the sine wave like this. And now you can measure what is the frequency. You can set this with the position here. This knob is for setting the vertical position of the waveform, and this knob is for setting the horizontal position of this waveform, correct? Now we will set the cursor so that we can measure the periodic time. Now if you see the second per division, this knob is there for the time. So here now you can see the 2-3 cycles are there. And if we say use the cursor, then I am pressing this cursor, and cursor number 1. So here the cursor number 1 is there, press this button. Now you can see that there is a movement of the cursor number 1. So set this cursor 1 on the one of the peak of your signal. Then the press cursor 2. So and now you set this position of the cursor 2. Set it on a peak of the cycle. So now here in this oscilloscope you can see the time difference delta t. It is indicating the 158 microsecond. It is a 158 microsecond. So from that you can calculate what is the frequency, or directly you can measure the frequency by pressing this button. By pressing this button, measure. So if I will press this measure, now you can see the channel 1 is there and the frequency is 6.43 kilohertz. Correct? So now if you want to change the frequency of oscillation, then either you can replace the resistance or you can change this value of the capacitor. So by changing the resistance and capacitor, we can change the frequency of oscillation. So in this experiment, for a 3 or 4 different value of the resistance, you have to measure what is the periodic time, you calculate the frequency, and then compare that value of the frequency with the theoretical formula, that is F is equal to 1 upon 2 pi RC, and verify your answer.